The following is a presentation of the Match Talk Podcast Network. It's time for the ODU Wrestling Monarch Matcast, a show dedicated to all things related to the Old Dominion Wrestling Program. On the web at monarchmatcast.com. Now, here's your host, three-time National Wrestling Writer and Broadcaster of the Year, and 2004 ODU alumnus, Jason Bryant.
Episode 71 of the ODU Wrestling Monarch Matcast. Today, going down to Birmingham, Alabama, which is something I didn't think I'd ever say on this show, but we'll be talking with four-time conference champion, two-time All-American, James Nicholson, who is the executive director of the Birmingham Wrestling Complex and a recent inductee into the ODU Sports Hall of Fame. Mr. Nicholson, been a while, man. How you doing?
Man, I'm doing great, Jason. I'm glad you're having me on.
I'm just noticing immediately you've been down in the South. You went from ODU to Chattanooga to Birmingham. We'll get to that route in a bit, but you have developed yourself a Southern accent, my friend.
You know, when you're down here for 3-4 years, it kind of sneaks up on you. You can't really help it.
So let's just talk about what you're doing right now before we get into your Hall of Fame career at Old Dominion. You've got a wrestling club down there in Birmingham, which was formerly known as the Vestavia Wrestling Club. For anybody that pays attention to wrestling, they know that Vestavia Hills High School is one of the top programs in the state. Actually competed in the Virginia Duels in 1995, the very second wrestling event I ever saw Vestavia Hills competed at the Virginia Duels. So there's a history there. Coach Steve Gadosh there for a long time was a big fan of Coach Gray Simons, who was running camps at Old Dominion back in the day before Steve Martin got the job. So there's some Old Dominion ties down there at Alabama.
There's some history there, yeah. So the Christian Stadler was my contact down here. That's how I got linked up with the Vestavia Wrestling Club. And, you know, one donor dropped a pretty penny on this place, and they really wanted to change the game for the South.
So you got a boy from Iowa ending up in Birmingham, but that's not the story. The story is how the boy from Des Moines, Iowa, ends up in Norfolk, Virginia. So before we even get to the recruiting process, you know, when did you discover wrestling? And in the state of Iowa, I'm assuming it's got to be pretty early.
Sixth grade, actually. It was late in the game for what most people think. I was a rambunctious kid. I was one of eight, and
eight kids. Yeah,
one of eight. Man, and some family friends were like prying, twisting my mom's arms, like, "Oh, you need to get your boys into wrestling. Oh, you need to, yeah, you just they'll fit right in. That's what they got to do." And when I first started out, like, I don't remember my first 3 years, to be honest. I really don't, because I'm pretty sure I lost every match or a lot of matches just because I was so late in the game. And I actually called my mom probably about 3 or 4 months ago. I was like, "Mom, you got to tell me how this went down, how this played out." She's like, "Yeah, you just hated losing. You hated it. Like, you went in there and you tried so hard, but you just weren't accomplishing what you wanted to accomplish." So I think that was, I liked the challenge of what wrestling provided. And I think that's why it stuck to me. And that's why I stuck to it.
How much of the learning curve is, you know, kind of lessened when you're in an environment like Iowa, where, you know, you can throw a rock and hit somebody that's a stud?
The learning curve. Oh man, goodness. It's rough. It was, I think I tell everybody this, I qualified for state when I was an eighth grader. So in Iowa, you have to qualify for state at the, when you're in middle school, and they take the top four from the region. Well, I placed fourth, out of four people. So it's pretty stout.
And that was a middle school state, right?
That was middle school. Yes.
Yeah. Cause the reason I have to preface that is because some states out in the Midwest, you can wrestle varsity in the seventh and eighth grade, like Minnesota, yes. Seventh and eighth grade. So I was traditional, like Virginia, 9 through 12.
Mm-hmm. That, down here in Alabama, it's actually, you could, I actually had a seventh grader wrestle for varsity states this year. So he was one away from qualifying for state as I think a third year wrestler, or been wrestling for 4 years. He's pretty stout. So, it's pretty fun, but yeah, up in Iowa, it's 9 through 12.
So what's the ideas of when you started realizing that, you know what, I want to wrestle in college? When did that start to enter the fray?
Oh my goodness. When I realized, like, we were poor and I needed a scholarship. It was probably about my freshman year, right after I was 88 pounds as a freshman in high school, and I needed to pick a sport, and obviously it wasn't football. I was still like, oh, you know, I'm gonna hit my growth spurt any minute. I'm gonna hit, you know, 150, 160, and I'm actually, you know, be able to compete with some of these guys, and it's just gonna happen any minute. And then I think I got stiff arm, or I went to go stiff arm somebody, and then I realized my arm was like 5 inches shorter than them. And I got put to my butt. I felt like I broke my tailbone. And then I was like, maybe football's not for me. Maybe I should choose a different sport. Now, that was where that was kind of the turning point. And then I was 15 and 18 as a freshman. I was, you know, I was small. I was underweight. I got routinely bumped up to 112. So I could, you know, we can have a trade-off for the team. I come off the mat one time crying, just like, because I lost 6-2 because I got bumped up, and everybody's patting me on the back, and I'm just like, why are y'all patting me on the back? And I just didn't get it back then. It's like I did something for the team. But that turning point was definitely my sophomore, or going to Fargo my freshman year, and going out there in All-American and Greco, and I was just like, okay, yeah, I could do this. This will be fun.
Yeah, nice to run for guys your own size, because there are a couple weight classes that are sub 100 pounds at the age group levels.
Yes, I was a small fry. I wrestled 91, and that was cadets. So that was it was fun. I mean, you know, I learned from we had a good camp. We had Zach Dominguez coach us that year, and man, he was a Greco guy. I think he was on the ladder. He was third on the ladder that year, and then him and his brother. So there was three of them. They did a standout job with us at the Iowa Fargo camp.
Yeah, no, Dominguez brothers known out of Nebraska. Zach wrestled there, and then Esai and Eli wrestled at Nebraska Omaha before they unceremoniously dumped the program. Yeah, Trev Albert sucks. Now, as we get to things that were kind of happening in Virginia at the time, Gray Simons, who was a coach at Old Dominion for 17 years, retired at the end of the 2003-2004 season. We often joke that was that class. That was part of my – I spent 7 years as an undergrad, and that was the year I got out, and that was the year a lot of my other guys got out as grad students and such. And I think that was the time Gray said, I've had it. These guys are out. I'm gone. Steve Martin gets the job 2004-2005. And immediately starts a regime change, a program cleansing, so to speak. And you come in 2000, let's see if I'm doing the math right. You get recruited 05, 06. You're a redshirt 06, 07. You start 07, 08. So take us through the process of, you know, getting on the radar for some of these schools, and then what you first remember about Lee Pritz and Steve Martin contacting you.
So how I got on the radar was it was definitely winning state my senior year. I beat Nate Moore and Lee Pritz,
who had signed with Iowa, who was number one or number two in the country at the time.
Yes, he's pretty stout, and we, you know, I put myself on the map after that. Had quite a few coaches contacting me, but it was spring. It was late. I was a senior. Money was dried up, and Willie Gatson gave a call to Lee Pritz, and I remember this story because Pritz told me this after the fact. He goes, you know, Willie Gatson's only called me about three people in my lifetime. So obviously, as soon as he called me, I had to give you a call. So I talked to Pritz for about 45 minutes on our first recruiting call, first phone call. And I'm 45 minutes into the conversation. I go, hey, coach, is ODU D1? And he's like, yes. Yes, it is. And I said, okay, you can keep talking. So that was kind of my introduction of mine, how I got introduced to ODU and how I got pulled down there. And, you know, what one thing that Pritz said to me that really, really stuck was, do you want to go to Iowa? Do you want to go to Iowa State? Or do you want to come out all the way to ODU and you want to be a part of something upcoming and create something special here? And I was just like, I had that underdog mentality. I've been an underdog my entire life. I was like, yeah, let's do it. That sounds fun. So, and then next thing you know, I'm surfing on a recruiting visit down there. And yeah, that kind of locked me in.
Yeah, and speaking about being the underdog, where, you know, high school wrestling in Iowa was super good, but, you know, there's power programs. And while your high school program wasn't a power program, it wasn't chopped liver by any means. What was it like wrestling at Des Moines Roosevelt?
Oh, goodness. So my senior year was it was nice. I mean, I had Montel Marion. He was my workout partner my senior year. And I had someone that picked me up after my sophomore year, after I wrestled in the districts. I lost in the finals to a kid that Al Garrison trained for a real a decent amount of time, and he thought that guy was just going to mop me. His name was Morley, so he thought I was just going to get mopped up. It ended up being like 5'4". And right after that, he pulled me into his office. I had a meeting with him. The family friends that had been trying to work with him for a very long time got me linked up with him. And he was a lawyer downtown. He sent me down to this Oval Office, like a 12-seat Oval Office. And I'm sitting there, and he puts a contract in front of me, just like, okay, this is a bit intense. But he asked me to sign it, and I signed it, and he stops me midway through. He's like, I want you to know what you're signing up for. Do you know what you're signing up for? He's like, yeah.
Well, did you read it before you signed it? It's not like the Apple terms of service.
No, I definitely, yeah, exactly. I didn't read it. I was like, man, you coach some of the best. Like, so I was like, yeah, no, we're going all in on this. And I mean, I kind of went off that deep end after my sophomore year. He really changed the game for me. I mean, Coach Jay Groth was a phenomenal coach. In the room, man. He knows how to run a room. He knows how to command a room, man. He knows how to organize and get the team behind him. He knows how to develop that camaraderie and that wrestling family. And then Al Garrison really came in there and just fine-tuned some of my technique, and really helped put me on the map, you know, because the amount of time he was willing to allocate towards me and my brother was insane. I mean, I've never met another man that was willing to put that amount of time in. I mean, we worked for probably anywhere from 2 to 3 hours after practice for years, all the way up until my senior year. It's like, and then every single time I went back from in college, I always went back and spent about 4 or 5 hours with him, showing him everything that I learned that entire year, putting it on tape so that way he could pass it on to that next generation. It was, yeah, it put me on the map.
And we look at getting to Old Dominion, once you get there and that process, and what did you know about? Obviously, you stopped Pritz when he said, you know, you say, is it D1? They had to answer that question a lot that year. But also part of that class was some guys like, you know, there was Chris Brown and LaShawn were in a previous class, some of early classes by Steve Martin. And then you and Billy Chamberlain, he's a PA state champ, you're an Iowa state champ. And there's some, it's like, oh no, we're recruiting too much at the weight class. And then with what's there. And when you first showed up to Norfolk, what were your general impressions outside, you know, you're surfing on your recruiting trip? Yeah, that's great. But once classes start, what were your impressions?
My impressions were, what did I just sign myself up for? A lot of people, you know, want to ask me the question, what's the difference between high school and a Division I program? I said the intensity, everything that you have in a high school program, it times it about 10, and that's what it is. They are shoving wrestling down your throat all day, every day, and you know, then you got to manage your class load on top of it. It was a big learning curve. I mean, I struggled that first, you know, 6, 7. I mean, I struggled my entire first year. I mean, in the wrestling room, man, I was a robot. People hated drilling with me. I was like, but I just worked hard. I mean, I'd get taken down 50 times by Christian Staler in a practice, but I'd still get up and turn right back in and pressure right back in. I don't know if it's because I was too stupid to know that I wasn't good and I need to slow it down, or I just wanted to win so bad that I was like, you know, I just got to go hard. I don't stop. Keep pushing forward. Then the classroom, to be honest, a lot of people said college was hard and difficult. I found it to be, it was nice. I enjoyed the freedom, you know, not sitting in a classroom for 8 hours a day and only having, you know, 12 hours. You go from sitting in a classroom 20, 30 hours a week to going down to 12 hours a week. That was nice. I was able to have a lot more freedom and be a little bit more efficient with my time and allocate a lot more time towards wrestling. So that first semester, though, goodness, just the stadiums alone nearly scared away. They scared a lot of people away, to be honest.
Yeah, and it's now a completely different stadium. Imagine what it'd be like now. But one thing that's interesting about your career is you had alluded to this, that said, yeah, you know, we were poor, I needed to pay for college. You actually came in on academic money. So you actually followed the model that most student athletes or college students should do anyway, is get the grades in high school. You can pretty much pick your spot academically.
You know, I went from having a 20 on my ACT to like, ooh, I need to get that up. That's not good. To having a 27 and taking it the second time. And that really, really, really helped with admissions and getting academic money. You know, Coach Martin, and you know, he set up a meeting with me and one of the admissions lady. I forget her name, but she was lovely. She was sweet, and she said, "Oh, okay, we'll give you the scholarship." And you know, when we first sat down, we were only talking like about $5,000 worth of academic aid a year, which is 20 grand. I was like, that's a decent chunk. Heck yeah. Well, it ended up being, 44,000, over the course of 4 years. And I was just like, ooh, I was ecstatic when I showed up and I saw that. I mean, I didn't even know about it. I didn't even know about it until I stepped on campus.
So it's one of those things, again, is that a lesson you kind of teach your kids today? You know, a lot of these parents are like, D1 wrestling scholarships, there are very, very rare full rides and opportunities to get academic money. Yeah. I mean, even Division III is non-scholarship athletically, but there's plenty of academic scholarship money at D3 schools, for example.
Yeah, that's one huge component about my club that I pitch. You know, it's as hard as you work in the room, it has to be matched with the classroom. It really does. And if a coach isn't hammering that home, they're not doing their due diligence to the community. I had a kid go from having a tutor and his dad spending $400 a month in lessons and getting help academically to all of a sudden having season B's, no tutors, nothing, all the way to straight A's, no tutors, nothing. Like no help, just from what he learned in the room and the work ethic that he learned, just go home, do your work, and it'll be taken care of. Wrestling's a privilege. That's what people need to understand. Sports are a privilege. If you're doing it and you're putting all your eggs in that basket, it's not a smart risk to take.
We look at what you learned in the room your freshman year. As we look at the ladder that year, Christian Staler was there, Kyle Hutter was there. You were third deck. You lost both your inter-squad matches your first time out. You're an Iowa State champ. I mean, was that kind of – I mean, yeah, you get in the room and you know what that matchups are like. And you put the single on, you're actually having a real match. Was that kind of a sobering experience for you?
Oh, you have no idea. Oh, my gosh. It was a rude awakening. It was like, man, is this for me? Is this for me? And I was like, to be honest, I really never thought of that. I was like, man, Kyle Hutter beat me 11-2. He mopped my face across the mat. And that's, you know, it's one of my best friends. I mean, and it was humbling. It was like, okay, I've got to work harder. I've got to make some changes. I've got to be in the room after the fact. You know, Coach Martin really, really helped out that year. I mean, I think he took me underneath the wing, and I think he spent more time with me than any other athlete at ODU that I've in my 9 years that I was in Virginia. Like he pulled me underneath his wing, and he helped me out tremendously. I mean, cause I was willing to work. And so one thing that I learned from, you know, growing up, it's like, I was just a workhorse. I wasn't the best always, but if you tell me to work, I'm going to listen. I'm going to do it.
We look at the dynamic of what happens with that roster. You know, you end up sliding in there at 25, then Hutter's up to 33. You know, we still haven't celebrated Ricky Bobby Night with Kyle Hutter. Polano and I have been talking about doing that for years. But and then some walk-on guy from Pennsylvania comes in and ends up winning the spot named Ryan Williams, who's eventually an NCAA finalist. And that lineup, that murderer's row of 25, 33, 41 that you guys had, what was it like to start that you know, duel meet off in that manner?
Jason, I just got goosebumps when you said that. I mean, I don't know. It was pretty insane. Like just hearing that brings back a ton of memories. You know, there's Ryan Williams' dad. He always, every single time I see him, man, murderers row. It's Mr. Williams was awesome. But I remember a story that Ryan shared with me a while back of going into Okie State's room. This place is completely oranged out. Stands, you know, it's packed. There's several thousands of fans in the stands. And all of a sudden, ODU steps out. They're on the mat. Me starting off versus Obi Blanc. Boom, I win. Boom, Kyle Hutter wins. Boom, Ryan Williams wins. You know, we have an Olympic gold medalist on the other bench, and we got the crowd just, you could hear a pin drop in that gym when they were down 9-0. They're like, ODU, where's ODU from? What the heck are they doing? It was, I really enjoyed kicking off and starting off that murderous row and getting everybody started and getting the momentum going. You know, one thing that people don't understand, wrestling is a team sport, and that momentum you generate from the 25 pounder to the 33 and on up, it can carry a team into a win easy.
Yeah, I mean, Joey Metzler was right there. Yeah. I mean, it was overtime right there. I mean, it could almost take. I remember reading the message boards during that duel, and Cowboy fans were melting down. They're like, we should never lose three matches to Old Dominion. And then what's interesting is later in the year, Jesse Strawn ended up pinning Clayton Foster at the at the national tournament, whereas that match was reversed. So if you look at things in a perfect world, it's like, man, I mean, it was like the best matchup ever for ODU Oklahoma State. Now, granted, you guys kind of like spent everything there because the Oklahoma match the next day or day after that was not so hot. But when you look at the opportunity, you're like, man, you went in and that's one thing that I will remember about that team is you won three straight in Gallagher, Iowa against the most storied college wrestling program in history. And they were ready to fire John Smith after 141. It was crazy. I mean, that might be a little bit hyperbole. They're not going to fire John Smith, but it was like, what is going on here?
Mutiny. They're like, where's this? What are they doing over there in Virginia? Man.
So your freshman year, you get to the show, and this is a tough weight in the conference. It's Steve Mittich from Drexel, Dave Thomasette from Hofstra. You and Mittich are freshmen. You guys would have a couple battles throughout the course of your careers. And, of course, Hutter had a lot of battles with him. And it was the triangle. And back in the day, the CAA seating was so janky. You ended up getting the one seed, even though that was up for discussion. You had beaten Thomasette twice, and that was pretty much what ultimately did it. And you won the conference. You ended up winning it four times. And going into nationals, you're the 10 seed. Mike Cease from Bloomsburg was a 7 seed, right? And you got the quarters. And then you've got Raleigh Peterkin from Penn in the blood round. You were down 4-1 late in the third period. Take us through that scenario.
You talk about reaching deep. You know, he had he had a minute and 27 or a minute 24 seconds of riding time when I got out, I believe. I think I was in the third, and I was doing some Gramby rolls. Like, one thing he did is he picked me up, and his coaches, they did a standout job scouting. They knew we were Gramby guys, and he picked me up, and he knew how to return. But I didn't care. I was like, nope, I'm getting out. I've got to get out. This is my only way. I end up basically spiking myself and tucking my shoulder and giving myself a nice herniated disc in my neck because of it. And taking injury time right after that. But as soon as I got back up, I looked at the clock. I was like, okay, 4-2. I mean, I got to take him down with about 30 seconds left. I need to get this done. So, I mean, I kept pressing forward. And I just jammed. As soon as I got my underhook, and I was like, ooh, this is your time. This is your time. I eventually scored. I came in. I tossed the boot in. I remember it was like it was yesterday. And I get the boot in. They throw up the two-hand. I glance over, and I took him down with 27 seconds left. So he had 57 seconds of riding time. Otherwise, I would have had to cut him again and get another takedown or try for a turn or something. But we go into overtime, and, you know, he's panicking a little bit just because I came back from this, you know, from a huge deficit, you know, in that third period. And he kind of dove in a little bit, and I backhanded him and got around behind him. And as soon as they threw up that two and blew the whistle, man, oh, goodness gracious. I had so much joy, like, and passion and everything. Just so many emotions all at once just poured through. It's like all the work that you put in, all the work from high school, all the work that you did as a redshirt, all the work that you did that year as a freshman, and to be, you know, to get on the podium as a freshman, it kind of changed ODU's eyes. And, you know, but some of these kids, some of these guys that were working, you know, they started to believe in themselves, and they started, oh, we can do this. We can definitely do this. So, you know, it really helped get the things going for the ODU program. You know, and I just remember my younger brother, John, he ran past like three security guards back in the tunnel to give me a hug. And that was seriously, that's one of my most, that's my favorite. That's my standout memory from ODU is that moment right there. Is having him, you know, come and congratulate me and, you know, looking up to me as a younger brother. It was just awesome. It's such a great experience, and I'm blessed to. I was blessed to, you know, have that happen. You know, it was wonderful.
Because the year before, and you know, as an alum and being in the media, I've got to pretty much be impartial, at least visibly. You know, you've got your rooting interests, and I can, you can see that a little bit now on Twitter, where you know I'll retweet the Monarch stuff, of course, my clients. But the year before, Staler is beating Matt Keller from Chattanooga, and in the same type of situation, although he's up, but he's riding time against, and you know, I'm sitting there, I'm I think I was working for Interman at the time, I can't remember exactly, but I'm sitting there and I'm stone faced at the top of the desk, but underneath the desk my feet are like underneath the table, and I'm just like, we had not had an All-American since 1995 when Nick Hall placed at heavyweight. He actually was an assistant coach for a short time in the old administration. But sitting there, and then Keller gets the takedown, and then all you got to do is bail out. You got overtime. Nope. Gets caught on his back. It was just like, and this letdown of, you know, as an alum, you're sitting here like, I'd never seen an All-American from ODU when I was a student. So it was like, and then I remember the flash forward the next year, there you are out there in overtime, and Todd Hibbs is the announcer at the time. And I remember he went Old Dominion with an All-American. Like, it was like, who the heck are these guys? So that was one of the cooler things I remember from that. Now, there's a lot of pressure that comes with that moment. People like, okay, you're an All-America as a freshman. People expect you to do that. Okay, you've done it once. You could do it again. What were the struggles in trying to repeat for the next 2 years?
You know, my sophomore year, it was like, okay, I got on the podium. And, it, you know, there's an interview on Flow, and I hate every single time you search James Nicholson wrestling. That's one of the first things that pops up. I hate it. I kind of got complacent a little bit. It's like, okay, I got to the show. I'm the man, you know. And I would just – I didn't stay hungry. I didn't put my foot to the gas pedal as much as I did. I kind of let off a little bit. And that's really, really difficult to admit as a competitor. You know, it's just, you know, I was kind of plagued with injuries, had some, you know, some low ankle or some high ankle sprains, some back issues, and, you know, some shoulder issues from jamming in so many underhooks. And it wears on your mind a little bit. But, you know, go to my junior year, same thing. You know, I wrestled the Central Michigan kid that year. He was ranked in the top 10 as was I. And we went to a barn burner of a match.
Was that in the Midlands? You're talking Scotty Sentes?
No, not Sentes. That was, I forget this guy's name. Not Scotty. It was the guy that won a lot of points, that won a lot of matches going on into OT. He was really good about keeping it close and neutralizing a lot of offense from the other guy. Real defensive wrestler. anyway, I come off the mat. I reached my I think Sentes bumped up to 33 that year.
And eventually beat Peterkin in the blood round.
Yep. Oh my gosh. But yeah.
Raleigh's a great guy, but man, he had that. All right, I'm going to look this up because I don't like not knowing names. So you keep telling the story, and I'll get the Central Michigan name here in a second.
So we have a barn burner match, and it goes to, I think, the third sudden victory or fourth sudden victory, and I eventually get out and
Matt Steintrager.
Yes, Steintrager. Okay, goodness. And I get off that mat, and I go to cool down. I was like, man, I went to go, you know, roll out my shoulder. I was like, man, that kind of hurts. You know, I put some ice on. I didn't really think too much of it. And the next morning, I woke up and I couldn't lift my arm 2 inches off my leg. And that was, you're talking about 4 weeks or before NCAAs and 2 weeks before conferences. I was pretty distraught. That was, you know, looking back, I stayed. That was the first year, or, you know, when you talk about depression, I was extremely depressed. I thought my season was over. I went full meltdown mode. I literally stayed in bed the entire day. I didn't go to class. I didn't do anything. I didn't even go to practice. And I got Coach Martin. He came over to my room. He walks in the room. He goes, Nicholson, what are you doing? And I went, what do you mean? It's like, I'm hurt. It's like, I can't do anything. He's like, well, then you need to go to the training room. It was just a simple conversation with my coach. He kind of put my mind back on track. And, you know, I started hit the training room every day, hitting the bike, you know, kind of rehabbing that as best as I could. And, you know, you go into the national tournament and you don't really have I wasn't on the mat. Like, I think I was on the mat, I think maybe a week or two. Like three or four times going before conference, and then maybe a week or two. Like, I mean, I wasn't hitting it hard those 2 weeks, but, you know, I was c- kind of conserving. And then I got to NCAAs and I'm wrestling the Purdue kid, and man, I get super ducked with like 4 seconds left on the first match. That was just a rough year, man. Just like plagued with injuries, and you know, just mine wasn't in the right spot. And senior year, I was like, nah, this is not happening again. I've got to find my way back on that podium. This is not, no, I can't, no. No, I mean, I woke up every single morning for 4 straight years, you know, staring at 2000, whatever year it was, 2008 or 2000, 2008, 2009, Division I, 125-pound national champ. You know, every single day staring at that in the mirror, you know, and looking at it and making sure I believed it, that I could do it. And, you know, it's I had a lot of work, you know, so, I mean, it's just I needed to get back on that.
One of those names that have come through and always been kind of a pain in your ass was a guy from Minnesota named Zach Sanders. You wrestled him in Fargo. You wrestled him in the Southern Scuffle. You wrestled him in the Nationals. You wrestled him at the All-Star Classic. And I mean, you did pick him off once in college, but he's one of those guys that would like never quit. And it's like, you'd be winning the match and he just found ways to win. How frustrating was it to wrestle a guy like Sanders?
You know, it extremely frustrating. I cut a decent amount of weight. And it really crippled me because a lot of people thought, I was like, oh man, he's gassed. It's like, put us in a practice room. I was like, man, I think it'd be a little different, but you know, that's part of the sport. That's part of the sport. Weight cutting is part of the sport. You got to make the weight. So, you know, he was a huge thorn in my side, man. Me and him, we clashed back and forth, but I'll tell you one thing. I always got the first one or two takedowns. he always got at the All-Star Classic. I got two takedowns and then in the first, and then I wasn't sitting or anything, but I was still pushing forward. But he moves well. He's been wrestling since he was 5. Man, he's got really good misdirections. Got good Greco. He's really good in battling out of my underhook stuff. So he couldn't. I would try to force some of my underhooks, and he just really knew how to put the gas pedal. And you know, maybe I just didn't know how to wrestle back then or game plan for a guy like that. You know, it is what it is. I mean, he's a standout guy. He's still competing. I mean, I love watching him wrestle. He's awesome.
One of the unique things about wrestling is back in when the NCAAs were in Philadelphia, a guy named Anthony Robles won the NCAA title for Arizona State. Tremendous story. Born without a leg. You had an opportunity to wrestle Robles early in your career. In a weird circumstance, the match actually was thrown out from counting in the records because the tournament didn't do a skin check, so all those matches were thrown out. So eventually that loss didn't hurt you in the seeding that year, but he did kind of pick up the victory there. And what was it like wrestling a unique guy like Anthony Robles?
You know, I'll tell you what, don't let him grab your wrist.
Ask Zach Sanders the same question.
Man, don't let him grab your wrist. Oh my goodness. Yeah, once he gets it, man, it's really difficult to get it back. You know, and then when you're wrestling him and you pull him down in front of the headlock, you're okay, I just got to go to this side. And you go to grab something, you're like, oh crap, there's not a leg there. What do I grab? So you had the game plan. I game planned him for him very, like a lot my senior year. And having a one match underneath my belt when I was a freshman, that really, really helped out helped. You know, it's hard to game plan for someone when you don't have any experience out there. You know, as soon as I was out there, I remember every moment of, okay, when I chase the corner and I go to grab normally I grab a leg or grab the hamstring or something. I was like, man, I got to go to the hip now. And he does a really good job of sitting through and pulling that arm over. And then, and if that happens, you can't come in and toss in a leg afterwards because there's no leg there to toss it in on. So it's extremely difficult, man. But don't let him have your wrist.
Looking through that senior year, you go in as the 4 seed. You're upset by Ben Kerr from Utah Valley, who's again got a unique story in his own. He actually ended up wrestling Robles in the semifinals. Dropping down, you've got to beat Alan Waters, Gerard Garnett, Nick Bedleon just to place. And looking back, you know, retrospectively, we can see that, oh, those guys had killer careers. That was a monster draw. What was it like, you know, your senior year, you get upset and you're like, crap, I'm in the same position I was the previous 2 years. What possessed you not to lose or at least hit that podium that senior year?
Will, sheer will, because, you know, I tell a lot of people, I wasn't I wasn't the best at the weight, but I'll tell you what, I was probably one of the toughest. I was ready for battle at all times. I mean, people asked me if I wanted to compete in the All-Star Classic, and I said yes both times. And it was like 4 and 5 days before. I mean, we just talked about the Okie State trip earlier and then wrestled Oklahoma. Well, what was unique about that, I basically had a 3-day weigh-in at scratch in a row. So I wrestled Okie State Saturday, Oklahoma Sunday, and then I flew out to the All-Star Classic and wrestled Falk from Iowa on Monday. It was packed.
And what's unique about that is I remember when you got the call, because you were the first one to wrestle in the All-Star Classic from Old Dominion. Do you know since when?
Oh, goodness, man. No, I do not. Deb, please tell me.
1970, guy named Wayne Bright. Do you know who Wayne Bright wrestled in the All-Star Classic?
Who did Wayne Bright wrestle in the All-Star Classic?
Dan Gable.
Oh, my goodness.
So the last guy to compete in the All-Star Classic from Old Dominion before you was Wayne Bright, who wrestled Dan Gable. Now, Wayne is also an interesting trivia question, because we all know that's the year that Gable lost to Larry Owings in the finals. The trivia question is, who is the last man Dan Gable beat in college? And the answer is Wayne Bright for two different reasons. One, it was the NCAA semifinals that year. And two, the All-Star Classic was after the season that year. So it was the same guy. So Wayne Bright is the correct answer for two different reasons.
Wow. That's crazy trivia. I like that.
Well, now, and then you got the opportunity to go back the next year. Well, first of all, what did it mean to represent ODU at the All-Star Classic? Because you wrestled Charlie Falk from Iowa. We had touched on your match with Sanders, but what did that event mean for ODU?
It put us on the map. You know, it's, you talk about, something that's aired nationally and put on by the National Wrestling Coaches Association. It was a huge honor to be a part of. So of course, when Coach Martin said, "Hey, do you want to do this?" It's right after this. And I said, "Well, I mean, do I get a pound?" They're like, he's like, "No, you got to make scratch." I was like, "Well, isn't the tournament at the end of the year 3 days?" And he's like, "Yeah." It's like, "All right, well, let's do it." I was like, I gotta try it. It got us more exposure, and it got us more out in front of the community. It got us out in front of the wrestling community, and got put ODU kind of on the map, or starting something. Now, like I said, I wanted to really contribute, do my part as a competitor, and help in any way I can. That's really one thing I knew how to do, is just put my time, my wrestling shoes on, and step out there on the mat and do what I can do. Win or lose doesn't matter to me. I mean, I'm just thankful to compete.
Any added pressure being from Iowa, wrestling a Hawkeye in that environment?
You know, no. He had great offense. You know, my freshman year, I still had a lot to grow. I still had a lot to learn. I knew how to wrestle. I knew how to slow the match down. Several of the kids that I wrestled, they were better than me technically. They really were. But I knew how to frustrate them. And I knew how to get underneath their skin. I had a decent underhook, and a lot of people, this kid's from ODU. Who is he? You know, so like I got taken for granted for a little bit. So, you know, but he was in on my legs quite a bit, and there wasn't any added pressure. To be honest, I was like, all right, now I got to go prove to these guys why they should have recruited me. And it didn't work out for me, but yeah, I mean, give me another chance, it might.
Back in October, you were inducted into the ODU Sports Hall of Fame, joining Gerald Lee, Sharice Grant, and Carlos Mendez. Now, I was at ODU with Sharice Grant and Carlos Mendez, so I remember them playing on their particular sports. What did you know about the class coming in prior to your induction?
No, Gerald Lee, I mean, yeah, I remember watching him play ball. He was a competitor, you know, and I don't know much about the other two. I said, but I knew Gerald Lee. He was 2010, I believe.
He was in there. He was in that range. Let me look at that. Paul, pull up the bio. Yeah. 06 to 10.
Yeah. He was, ODU had a great basketball team when I was going through. Kent Bazemore plays for the Blackhawks, I believe.
Blackhawks is the hockey team. It was the Hawks.
Hawks, my bad. Oh, goodness. Yeah, see, that shows you how much I know about basketball.
Well, it's expected. Yeah, you mixed up two indoor arena sports. That's fine.
but at least
you knew who Bazemore was. I follow him on Twitter.
I know who Bazemore is. Yes, he's, you know, and I actually, you know, being All-American in that year helped me, secure my spot as the MVP for ODU that year, or the most talented athlete to come out of sports in 2011. So being inducted into the Hall of Fame, man, that was a huge honor. It was kind of eye-opening. I never looked back, or I never in my journey once said, okay, this is my plan. This is what I'm going to do, and I'm going to be inducted to the Hall of Fame. So to be rewarded for what I did nearly a decade ago, it was huge to be a part of. And it's huge for my career down here in Alabama. It helped go, oh, he's coaching where? So it helped catapult my career down here a little bit.
Yeah. One thing with the identification, because a lot of without growing up in Virginia, I grew up in Virginia, so I had ODU season basketball season tickets, men's and women's basketball. I'd been familiar with the sports programs, but coming from outside and not really knowing anything about ODU before you got there, what did you learn to appreciate about Old Dominion athletics as a whole during your time?
Field hockey, they're king. They were the sport when I got there. And I'm from Iowa, so I mean, the field hockey doesn't really exist or didn't exist. I just didn't know much about it. Same thing with lacrosse. It's like, so I mean, there was a lot of respect for some sports that I didn't know a lot about. The athletics, the amount of passion that the administration puts into the sports and the community that puts into the sports and into the facility. And that's why I was so ecstatic when they started up football. I was like, they need to keep some of these kids that are in the Hampton area here at ODU, because there's talent right in the state. ODU athletics has been on the rise ever since.
Going back in time to talk about that first call with Pritz, and then there's the introduction to Steve Martin, who you said took you under his wing for a lot of that first season and during your time in Virginia. Steve's a hard guy to get to know, and he looks very abrasive from the outside. What did you learn more about Steve Martin during your time there that you wish more people would know about?
I'll tell you what, he doesn't. I describe him like wine. He's it's not for everybody, but for the people that like wine, he can really take you and turn you into a competitor. He can really turn you into a phenomenal athlete. I was drilling with him. I was probably one of the last athletes he drilled really, really hard with. And at one point he returned me or did something. And I kind of tweaked my knee a little bit. And he said, oh, are you okay? And like all of a sudden I just saw emotion from him. And he's really good about hiding his emotion from his pupils, basically. And when I saw that, I was like, okay, he does care. He really does care. And that's all I needed. That's all I needed to know, that he cared about me as an individual and as a human being and not just as a competitor. He lives, eats, breathes the sport of wrestling, and he's been a huge component in changing the game at ODU.
Now, as far as what you're doing now down in Alabama, explain the Birmingham Wrestling Complex, how you ended up down here. You had alluded to that Christian Staler had it, but you had gone from there. Before there, you were in Chattanooga.
Mm-hmm. So I was coaching for Baylor School up in Chattanooga, Tennessee. It's a prep school. And Christian Staler was down here. I knew they were building something. I knew they were building a complex strictly for wrestling. They pumped that a ridiculous amount of money into a 10,000 square foot facility. And the way they were structuring it was going to make it super, not super easy, but they were going to make it. They wanted to eliminate a lot of obstacles that a lot of coaches have with fundraising. Instead of my focus being shifted to fundraising, I was allowed to basically focus strictly on wrestling and not have to worry about some of those other things. I mean, I got a 4,500 square foot of mat space, two full size mats. We have other things besides wrestling to help support the program. So we have like a women's box that I moved an MMA gym in here. And I'm doing other things. We've got a study room that my assistant, Emron Galizeta, is starting up, and he's starting up a tutoring company, and we're diversifying this place, not just in wrestling. So we're not strictly focused on wrestling. We're making it more of a community center and trying to build up the community. And just when you do that, you give back to the community will give back to us.
So what's the future hold for James Nicholson?
Future? Man, I'm going to be in wrestling for a long time until I can't walk, basically. I really enjoy the club coaching. This is my third year down here. It's difficult for a coach. Every single day I'm just like, man, do I want to do it again? Do I want to put another year? And the reward I get from it, seeing the kids come off the mat, win or lose, the amount of change I see in them, from a young athlete to all the way up to the high school to when they leave high school. It's something that, you can't ever take away. The measurement. There's no monetary measurement. You can't. It's the amount of change that you have and the impact you have on the younger generation. And as long as I'm keeping doing that, as long as I have an impact, a positive impact, I'm going to keep on doing it for as long as possible.
How can people keep up with what you're doing right now?
Go follow us on Instagram and Facebook. It's at the BW Complex. We do summer camps down here. We do wrestling down here. I'm bringing in Joe Dubuque from Princeton. He's coming in for a camp June 1st through the 3rd, and I'm bringing in Matt Storniolo from the Northwest or from Northwestern, and he's coming in doing a camp at the end of June. I'm really trying to change the game down here. Bring something down to Alabama that they just haven't seen. So I'm putting wrestling on the mat down here.
Is part of the Matt Talk Podcast Network. For more wrestling podcasts, head over to MattTalkOnline.com.